Good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome to our Good Friday service. Let's pray together. Father, as we come before you tonight, we're gathered with our thoughts filled with what you've done for us. The Last Supper, the washing of your disciples' feet, sending Judas out on his final errand, all because of your love for us. We thank you, Lord, as we spend our time with you tonight together. We pray that you would open our hearts to all you have for us tonight, Father. Amen.
You gave your life away for me. There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. All the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in.
Tell God has something great that he is planning to do tonight, because the attacks are coming fast and furious, and I am not the only person in this room who has been undergoing those attacks. So it just, God's got something special in store for us tonight. Of course, Satan doesn't like that, being the lying, thieving cheat that he is. Tonight, for Good Friday, you know, we've talked before about the events that transpired on that day, the day when our Lord was crucified. I want to try something a little bit different tonight and talk about the significance of it, the meaning of it, and exactly what Jesus accomplished for us on the cross. Our main text for tonight is Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. And in Galatians chapter 3, verse 13, we read, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Father, we pause for a moment to ask that you would reveal yourself to us this evening. Your word promises that you will give your wisdom liberally to all who seek it, without reproach. We claim that promise now as we offer you a small portion of our time. We ask you to take this time and use it to advance your kingdom in our hearts and in our minds. Help us to honor the memory of your Son, what your Son did for us, what you had to watch in order that we might enjoy renewed fellowship with you. You made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear what your Spirit would say to us this evening about our King, Jesus, and it's in his name that we pray, amen. So as you consider this verse from the book of Galatians, you can remember that Paul was writing to a group of people who had forgotten a lot about what was truly important in their walk with Christ. They had forgotten to a degree what Christ had accomplished for them. Many of them sought to justify themselves through the law, and, you know, Christ, but the scripture says that Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to those who believe. That's from Romans chapter 10. So Paul reminds the Galatians and he reminds us that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. You might be wondering just what that means. What is the curse of the law? Well, as recorded in Leviticus chapter 26, God first told the children of Israel how he would bless them if they were obedient and if they walked in his ways. He promised them glorious blessings. He went on to tell them what would happen to them if they were to break the law and to go after other gods. He told them he would bring his terror upon them, wasting diseases and fever that would destroy their eyes and cause sorrow of heart. They would sow their seed in vain, for their enemies would consume the fruits of their labors. They would be slain by their enemies. They would flee even when nobody was chasing them. Their situation would become dire. They would become so famished that they would eat their own children. Their land would be laid waste, the cities destroyed. They would be scattered among the heathen. The ultimate curse of the law was death. And there's an interesting passage in Deuteronomy chapter 21. Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 22 says, if a man has committed a sin deserving of death, and he is put to death, and you hang him on a tree, his body shall not remain overnight on the tree, but you shall surely bury him that day, so that you do not defile the land which the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance. For he who is hanged is accursed of God. And surely, that's the passage that Paul had in mind when he wrote Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. He showed that Christ became the curse for us. He took our sins upon himself when he was hung upon that tree. He took God's curse. He bore God's curse against sin. Now, when Adam sinned, he brought God's curse upon man, upon woman and man, and upon the earth itself. God told Adam that he would be cursed, that the earth wasn't going to just bear fruit for him as it had in the past. From then on, God told him, you're going to have to earn your bread by the sweat of your brow. The earth would actually bring forth thorns, briars, and thistles. And for your Lord of the Rings fans, I get this image of Smeagol saying, and they doesn't taste very nice, does they, precious? But God was telling Adam, it won't be easy for you to harvest your crops. You're going to have to do it by the sweat of your brow. Up until then, the earth had just produced. You could go out and get whatever you wanted and just enjoy it. The curse brought thorns, briars, and thistles. It brought hard labor, and that's what it took for man to eke out a living from the ground. And that is still true to this day, is it not? God said that the curse would come upon women in childbearing, labor pains, and all that kind of stuff. Apparently, up to that point, childbearing would not have been painful. Wouldn't it be nice if kids just kind of shot out without any effort or pain? I've been told, as I've mentioned before, that multiple times that giving birth can be somewhat painful. So there was a curse upon man, upon woman, and upon the earth itself. There was a curse on the serpent, too. It would have to crawl through the dust of the earth on its belly. We were in Santee a few days ago. We had to pick something up at Calvary Chapel Santee, and Karen was driving. She noticed something moving right there on Summit Road. Something was crawling across the street. It was a snake. And not just any snake, it was a rattlesnake. And that snake exhibited the curse of the serpent. It slithered across the street on its belly. Now, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for the likes of us. Can you imagine that? Man, if I had to live according to all of those rules and regulations, I wouldn't last a day. I would have been stoned to death a long time ago, and I don't mean stoned in the California sense of the term. By the standards of the law, I was condemned to die. But Christ has redeemed you and me from the curse of the law, because he became a curse for me and for you. He bore the curse for me because it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree. Isn't it interesting that when Roman soldiers made a crown for Jesus, what kind of a crown did they make? That's right, it was a crown of thorns. Why thorns? Because of the curse. The crown that Jesus bore upon his brow was really a sign of God's curse against the earth because of sin. The crown of thorns was really a very fitting crown because Jesus came to bear God's curse against your sin. He was then hanged upon a tree, redeeming you from the curse of the law, and every one of us fell under this curse. The law also declared, cursed is the one who does not confirm all the words of this law by observing them, and all the people shall say amen. That's from Deuteronomy chapter 27. The idea that Paul was putting across is that if you're seeking a righteous standing by keeping the law, you're already under the curses pronounced in the law because you've already broken the law. Now, if you keep the whole law but violate it in one point, you're guilty of all. You can't just keep the parts of the law that you like, that you agree with. You have to keep the whole thing. If you break one commandment, you're guilty. It's really immaterial which one you might have broken. Because of that, Paul concludes that nobody is justified in God's sight by the law. For the sake of argument, though, let's say that you're some kind of an exception. You're a perfect person. You've lived your entire life without breaking a single commandment. And then one day, you're on your way home from church. You're on the freeway, and all of a sudden some nut swerves in front of you, and he suddenly hits the brakes. You get angry, and you swear at him as you rear-end his car, and you die in the accident. Well, he came close, but he came up short. The Bible tells us that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. That means we're all guilty. What can we do? Are we without hope? Must we all be accursed? No. On the authority of the Word of God, I can tell you that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. How? By taking the curse upon himself for us. I'm the guilty one. I deserve to be hung on a tree. Jesus came and took my guilt. He hung on the tree for me. The scripture makes it abundantly clear that Jesus bore my sin for me. How does the scripture make that clear, you ask? Well, first of all, it was prophesied. Isaiah prophesied that the Messiah would suffer and be disfigured, but he also declared he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement for our peace was upon him. All we like sheep have gone astray, every one of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. It's from Isaiah chapter 53. And then a little later in that chapter, for the transgressions of my people he was stricken. The second way scripture shows us that Jesus bore my sin for me, your sin for you, Jesus himself said the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. It's from Matthew chapter 20. Now, when Jesus gave the cup to the disciples at the Last Supper, he said, "For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the remission of sins." In Matthew chapter 26, he said that. Thirdly, the epistles also testify to his death for all. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21 says, "For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." Titus chapter 2, verse 14, "Who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works." But wait, there's more. Hebrews chapter 9, "But now once, at the end of the ages, he has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed for men to die once, but after this the judgment, so Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many." Peter also addressed the subject. 1 Peter chapter 1, "Knowing that you are not redeemed with corruptible things, like silver or gold, from your aimless conduct received from tradition, by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot." And then in 1 Peter chapter 2, "Who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you are healed." We've now established that the law contains a curse for those who don't keep the whole law. We've defined that curse. We've also seen that we're all guilty, that we all deserve that curse. If the discussion ended there, we'd be in pretty bad shape, wouldn't we? We would be without hope. But the discussion doesn't end there. We've also seen that Jesus' sacrifice on the cross has completely redeemed all who accept him. We're no longer under the curse. The redemption that we have in Jesus is not just, it's not just negative. It doesn't just save us from the curse of the law. It also brings us into the blessings. The blessing of Abraham has come on the Gentiles. You remember that in the book of Genesis, God told Abraham, "In your seed, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed because you have obeyed my voice." That's from Genesis chapter 22. This was God's declaration to Abraham that the Messiah would be one of Abraham's descendants. That blessing was to extend to all the nations of the world. God said, "It is too small a thing that you," meaning Jesus, "should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel. I will also give you as a light to the Gentiles, that you should be my salvation to the ends of the earth." That's from Isaiah chapter 49. You know, it must have driven the devout Jews nuts when they heard him say that. Because Gentiles, non-Jews, were less than human to the Jews. They were fuel for the fires of hell. And here is Isaiah saying in God's name, I will give you as a light to the Gentiles, that you should be my salvation to the ends of the earth. Isn't that remarkable? And just a couple of chapters later, Isaiah said, the Lord has made bare his holy arm in the eyes of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our God. That's from Isaiah chapter 52. And one night, many years later, a group of shepherds were watching over their flocks in the field. And all of a sudden, an angel of the Lord stood before them. The glory of the Lord shone around them, and the Bible tells us that they were sore afraid. And that was a reasonable reaction. But it wasn't the reaction that the angel was looking for. So he said, be not afraid. For behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. That's from Luke chapter 2. Now, we Gentiles might receive the promise of the faith, of the Spirit, I should say, through faith. God had promised to put his Spirit on Israel and to give them a new heart. Ezekiel chapter 36 says, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you, and I will cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments, and you will do them. But God didn't stop there. He also promised to pour out his spirit on all flesh. Joel wrote, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also on my men servants and on my maid servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days. That's from Joel chapter 2. That is the offer that God is giving to you and to me today. The law has sentenced you to death, but Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died in your place. He took the curse of the law and he hung on the cross for you. He became a curse for you and for me, that he might redeem us from that curse of the law. This gives us glorious insight into God's grace toward us through Jesus Christ. In writing to the Corinthian believers, Paul said, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might become rich. That's quite a deal, isn't it? He was so rich, yet for your sake, he emptied himself. He became poor. Yet through his poverty, you might know the riches of God's love and grace for you. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. On a trip to Israel, my son Michael and I got baptized in the Jordan River, in the same general area where our Savior was baptized. And I might have mentioned this before, but one thing I can tell you is that water was cold. When people get immersed in cold water like that, it will sometimes take their breath away. As they come up out of the water, you can see them sort of gasping because of the coldness. They try to catch their composure again. I mean, it is a shock when your 98.6 degree body is suddenly immersed in freezing cold water. It's a shock. I wonder what kind of a shock it must have been to Jesus, who was so totally pure, to all of a sudden have every sin that would ever be committed dumped on him. Every rotten, evil thing that mankind has ever committed, in one moment, was dumped on his shoulders. Every perverted thing that man had ever committed was dumped on him. What a shock that must have been. And yet, God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. He redeemed us from the curse of the law. He became a curse for us, hanging there on that cross. Because he did that, you can have a new heart and a new spirit. God has given us such a marvelous invitation, hasn't he? You can come and lay all your burdens and all your cares upon him, all your sin. You can be transformed by the power of his Holy Spirit to live a life that will be rich in blessings. Perhaps someone here tonight is experiencing the consequences of living a sinful life. Maybe you've begun to experience some of these curses that God has declared. Your life perhaps has become a real mess. And things are looking dark. Sin is beginning to take its toll. But Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." That's from Matthew chapter 11. He will deliver you from the curse of the law. Instead of the curse, you can be blessed of God in all that you do. God said, "I'll bless you when you come in, and I'll bless you when you go out." Up one side and down the other. The blessings of God are offered to every one of us today through Jesus Christ. You can be a new person. Past sins will be forgiven, and all things will become new. God will give you a fresh start. To me, that's a marvelous invitation, and it's open to every one of us. Let's pray, shall we? Oh, Heavenly Father, your love, your mercy, your grace, they're just overwhelming to us. They are such great concepts. It is pretty much impossible for us to wrap our heads around those wonderful truths. But you haven't called us to understand everything about you. You just called us to believe it, to accept it. And we gladly do that tonight, Lord. We gladly celebrate your Son, what he did on that cross, crucified by the same people who a week previously had been chanting Hosanna to the Son of David. And so now, Lord, we just want to remember you by celebrating communion. We honor you, we praise you, we worship you. Help us to live our lives for you now. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now Pastor Tom is going to come forward and lead us in communion.
Good evening. Thank you for your prayers for Julie and Aaron. I think we had some angels working on the highway. So this is Good Friday. Why do we call it good? It wasn't good for Jesus. It wasn't good for his followers, his disciples, his mother. Lots of people. But it's very good for us because of all the things that Pastor Sean has just said. Without Jesus, it's hard to imagine, really. Because if we had never known Jesus, we wouldn't know what we didn't know. But think of the people you know that don't know Jesus, don't care about God, and look at their lives, look at their priorities, look at their struggles, and they have no place to go. No redemption, no freedom from the sins in their lives. They don't even realize they have sins sometimes. So we are so blessed that Jesus had the courage to do what he did, because he had tremendous, unbelievable courage, because I think he knew pretty much what was going to happen. And the worst part, I think the biggest agony that he had in the Garden of Gethsemane when he was praying drops of blood, was knowing that he was going to carry the sins of the world, past, present, and future, with him on the cross, and be separated from the Father for the only time in his existence. So he paid a price. And it's inconceivable for humans to think that a God would do that. Gods don't do those kinds of things. God's rule, God's command, God's destroy and manipulate, and they're capricious, but not our God. Those are all man-made and satanic gods who are like that. We have a God, the real God, the true God, the creator God, who is loving and compassionate and merciful and gracious beyond our ability to understand. The passage I want to read is from the Passover meal they had together. And this is just hours before he's arrested. Just mere hours before that happens. I'm going to go back to this is my Mark 14:17. I'm going to go back to where he talks about Judas a little bit. In the evening he came with the 12. Now as they sat and ate, Jesus said, "Assuredly I say to you, one of you who eats with me will betray me." And they began to be sorrowful and say to him one by one, "Is it I?" And another said, "Is it I?" He answered and said to them, "It is the one of the 12 who dips with me in the dish. The Son of Man indeed goes just as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been good for that man if he had never been born." As they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many. Assuredly, I say to you, I will no longer drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." So we copy that 2,000 plus years later. We share in communion because it reminds us of what he did, and it binds us together as a family. I think that's very important that we do that. So that's why we do this a couple times a month. We hope it doesn't become ritual. I do my best to make it not like that. But nevertheless, it can still be that way. But as we prepare for communion, let's just think about something concerning Jesus on the cross that touches you. It can be very personal. It can be whatever God speaks to your heart about. But most of all, I feel grateful tonight, not only for Jesus and what he did, but the recent thing with Julie and Aaron on the highway. They could have had a really bad accident, and it didn't happen that way. Just a mere scuff on their bumper. Amazing. So as we do the communion song, let's think about what God wants to do in your life next. Thank you. know, there are those who believe that religion is all man-made. It's all a creation of somebody's imagination. And I don't think there's a human being that's ever lived on the earth that could come up with a story that the Bible tells about our God and His Son. Amen. And His death for us. Amen. Not possible. People don't think like that. Only our God could imagine it, not only imagine it, but carry it out and make it so real. And then change us. We're changed. When we give our heart to Christ, we're changed. That's not imaginary. That's a real thing. So, as we take the bread together, Jesus, thank you. We can't say it enough. For what you did, obeying your Heavenly Father, going to the cross, taking that beating for us, sacrificing your body on our behalf. You may take any. And Jesus, for this juice that represents your blood, again, immeasurable, beyond our comprehension, that you would do this, and that you would create the scenario that your blood had to be shed to be a cleansing agent for us. I don't entirely understand that, but I know you did it. I know it's true. So we're thankful, Lord, that you initiated this remembrance, this communion, that we could always think again and remember the sacrifice you made for us. Thank you for your blood that cleanses us from our sin. You may drink.
Awesome. Well, if you'll join us in standing, please.
The same love that opened eyes. calling us to the cross.
Amen, Lord. Amen. Thank you for your love, mercy, and grace for each of us, Lord. Amen.
And now may God's love just prepare your hearts as we, of course, we celebrate his resurrection every day, not just on one Sunday out of the year, but may he just bring to you a new understanding of exactly what that empty tomb means, the hope that we have from it. May you just have a blessed Easter, and may God just pour out his mercy and grace in your hearts and through you, in Jesus' name. Amen. You are dismissed.